So this talk is, lightning talk is very, very quick. I think it's going to be a bit shorter than some of the others that have been here this evening. And it came off the back of a conversation from the last .NET meetup that we had about naked types and about primitive types. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. My name's Daniel Bryars. I'm a technical director at a company called speak.com. We are based here in Oxford. Well, we would be if we went in the middle of the pandemic, but we'll be returning back to the offices hopefully sometime later this year. I mostly program in C Sharp. I have quite a lot of experience. I'm older than 44, less than 46, and 20 years coding experience. And I like playing with Raspberry Pis and building stuff and doing robotics. But and we are hiring. So talk to Curriculo, because I think we're hiring through Curriculo. So if anybody wants a job in Oxford. Over that time, that sort of 20 years, I found that quite often it's the simple things that certainly trip me up in software. And the examples that I'll show you in here, they seem very trivial, but they are they're things which have caught me up before, and they take sometimes a very long time to find the root problem when there's something so easy. So it's normally the simple things that trip me up. This presentation, I've just popped in a GitHub repo that's down at the bottom. So I'm talking about primitive types. I'm not talking about the C-sharp primitive type here. I'm using the word primitive to mean a basic type or a naked type, a type which is not the defined built-in types in C-sharp, the ones which reserve keywords and things. So although they are primitive, so longs, chars, doubles, GUIDs, strings, these are things which they represent values, types, things, but they don't carry any semantic reasoning about it. So you can't tell from looking at a long what that represents. You can tell from the name of the variable, and obviously there's lots of techniques, Hungarian notation, stuff like that, to kind of build in what type, what kind of thing that long represents. But it doesn't have any business logic reason about what that is. And so this can lead to things where you might define a method, and you've got a couple of strings in there, and you've got to make sure that you read that the password is being passed before the username. If we call it like this, then unfortunately our username and password is the wrong way around. And I've seen this, and I've seen it in unit tests, and the unit tests are all correct and everything goes well. And everything, it's not until you hit production when somebody actually notices that, oh yeah, when we actually set the fact that somebody hasn't used user and user as a username and password for tests and things like this, that we find a problem. And it's a simple thing, but it just explains one of the kind of the problems that you've got, that password, and to the compiler, these are the same things. It's a similar thing with IDs. So I've got a GUID here, tenant ID, and a GUID here, pack ID. And I don't know whether or not there's no real difference between a tenant ID and a pack ID. They're, as far as I'm concerned, they're just they're just GUIDs. So it's easy to get these things wrong. So what we really want to do is we want to pass in something that represents this tenant ID and a pack ID. We want to evolve the type from it being this naked GUID to being something which is a tenant ID and a pack ID. This is a sort of a similar related idea to a type def in C, where you've got some maybe a pointer to a value. You don't want to have to keep writing this out. You've got this type, so you write a type def, and that just gets replaced by the compiler. So I could have tenant ID is actually this type. Now in C, it doesn't do strict type def checking. So that wouldn't help in this scenario. It would just still let you pass it through. And I think actually there were some plans to try and improve that in C and C++, but they weren't ever, I don't think they went anywhere. So we have to kind of do this the poor man's way if we want to do it, which kind of, because we can't do this, we can't inherit from value types. It's just not allowed. And we, most of these primitive types that we use are sealed. So a GUID is sealed, we can't extend it. So we can't make it our own, we can't sort of give it our own label, if you like, for the compiler. And so you've got to kind of do this yourself. But what's a little bit, what takes away a bit of the ceremony is that we could use a record. And the nice thing about a record is, so instead of using a class, what this record does is the compiler writes a class behind the scenes for you, and it makes a property called value, initializes it with the value that you pass in here of type GUID. It makes that an init-only property. It also provides some other nice boilerplate code that you'd usually need to write for this kind of thing. So it overrides equality for you. It does the two string for you, get hash, all the kind of the stuff that you'd have to write. So if you want to do this, then the ceremony isn't as much now as it used to be. Before, if you wanted to write a tenant ID, which was actually a GUID, then you'd have to write a class and you'd have to do all that stuff. But this record makes it a little bit nicer. So it makes this pattern a little bit more attractive. And then when you want to use it, the compiler is going to check. If I accidentally passed in the pack ID instead of the tenant ID, then I get a compile time failure, which is much faster in the development process. And it's not too painful. I just need to call dot value on here to get the real underlying value. And we found that there's a balance. You don't want to turn every int or char into its own type. But it's been really useful for catching some errors, especially for things that you use all the time, where you're passing lots of maybe GUIDs in a row or something like that, where you've got tenant ID, user ID, stuff like that. Another example of digging through some of our code where we've used this before is we had a bug a while ago where we were double encoding some user input, and we also wanted to check our code for security to make sure that we were actually encoding user input before we rendered it back out to a browser. So this is a few years ago, but you can imagine something like this, where you've got some way of encoding your HTML, and there's some code at the bottom, and you want to encode the user input, something puts a comment in, and you want to encode that before you write it back out to the browser. And this code here happens to encode it twice. And that's bad, or maybe you haven't encoded it at all. And so what you can do is you can lever this so you can lean on the compiler to tell you. So if you have a type that maybe represents encoded string, and this is a bit verbose, but this is just lifted out of some code that we had from an old code base. I've just made it fit on one screen. We've got this HTML safe encoded string. And the idea of this is that I can use it and pass in a string value from my untrusted source, and it initializes itself from untrusted, which turns out to encode this string. So I'm putting some guarantees around this and I'm putting some meaning around this string. I'm saying it's an HTML safe encoded string, and I've got a method here which is initialized from untrusted to make it absolutely explicit that down here, initialized from trusted, to make it absolutely explicit with a big warning that, you know, you really shouldn't be using this. So the default is a fail safe that it will initialize and it will encode that data. And then you've really got to go out of your way. And then by doing this and by representing values such as encoded strings, safe strings, passwords, so on and so forth, you can let the compiler tell you without having to write F-sharp that you're safe and you can check for these bugs. And we wrote this and we introduced it into the code, and then the compiler told us, hey, you're passing this here, and we found our problems, which was, it was a large sprawling code base. I think Richard might be on the call. He worked on that as a contractor a while ago. Not that he introduced the bugs, it was probably me, but this really helped us by promoting that from being a string to being something that represented this semantic, and then the compiler checked all the way through and told us our bugs. Just a few tips. Do avoid these naked primitive types if it helps. And from my experience, I found that user IDs, that GUIDs, that kind of stuff is good. Username and password. Password you should probably be storing as a secure string anyway, but and do use types that know what it semantically is. That can really help the compiler give you any problems. And don't use it too much. It can be laborious, especially if these types leak outside of your framework into other things, and people have got to it ends up coupling your libraries together. When of course if you're just using those basic types, then they are available everywhere. And don't serialize them. don't provide operator overload to convert between the types. The whole point of it is that you can't cast a tenant ID to a GUID. You have to explicitly know what it is, otherwise the compiler will just pass it in and you lose your safety, so don't do that. It would be nice if there was an unceremonious way where we could extend along or something and we could give it a type. And that is the a sort of a lightning quick talk on evolving from primitive types. I don't know if anybody's got any questions. Thank you. Next up is Kevin Smith with Just an Index.